All right, this is the College of Complexes. All you who wandered in unknowing should remember that it costs you $3 just to breathe the air of our and listen to our speakers and the rest of us. But with the $3, if you pay that, you are entitled to ask questions of our speaker, who tonight is Bill Lee, who has spoken here before at least two or three times. So three times before.
The killing in Chicago for fun and profit. Well, what is it, Bill?
I was told he wanted to talk about concealed carry, which is coming to Illinois and Chicago.
Yes. Welcome, our speaker. Okay.
Y'all for concealed carry. Good. Excellent. Y'all for concealed carry here in Chicago? Yeah, looking forward to that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? Excellent. Excellent. Let's see. Let me just ask a question. Say in the last 30 years, what was the common factor of all the mass murders with firearms? What was the common factor? Throw out some ideas.
Young people.
NRA members.
You think? Really? I did not know that. I'll have to check my figures, but I can't think of it.
Republican.
They all occurred in gun-free zones.
Thank you.
Okay? Think about that. What'd Chicago have? Top 500 murders last year? Chicago being a gun-free zone in itself. You have to understand that you're going to have danger and you'll be very vulnerable if you're in a gun-free zone. Especially when concealed carry comes. Now, the bill that they passed in the House in Illinois is known as HB 183. Okay, so if you want to learn up about that, HB 183. It's a shall issue bill. There's two different kinds of concealed carry. There's a may issue and shall issue. I lived in New York State, by the way, and I had a concealed carry permit for New York State. That was a may issue state. Luckily, I was in a county where they were gun friendly and just went through the process, takes about 4 months. So I had a permit I could carry most anywhere where it was legal, except New York City, of course, like Chicago, they're an entity unto themselves. Shall issue means that unless law enforcement or the government has a reason why you cannot or should not be entitled to carry, they have to give it to you. Okay, so HB 183, I'm going to tell you what it entails. You have to be 21 years old. You already have to have get a FOID card. That's the firearm owner's identification card, which I always carry on me when I'm carrying a gun. And it requires 16 hours of training. Now, military people and law enforcement and other people, they get 8 hours credit. So they would only have to have 8 hours of training. A non-resident can apply for a permit that would cost them $300. In Illinois, it's going to cost $150. That's just for the permit. The training will easily cost you another $75 or $100. The permit's going to be good for 5 years, and to renew it takes another 3 hours of training. There's a lot of prohibitions for this carry ordinance. And remember that gun-free zones are target-rich environments. That's where your mass murders occur. So I would stay out of these gun-free zones as much as possible because that's where you're really endangered. So the gun-free zones will be, and this includes parking lots as well. Not only the property inside the building, but also parking lots. It would be prohibited to carry concealed. Hospitals, nursing homes, mental health facilities, buses that are publicly financed, trains publicly financed, business establishments where more than half of their income is derived from the selling of alcohol, events, gatherings that require a permit, so I guess that'd be like a parade, requires a permit, playgrounds, athletic venues, all the stadiums, auditoriums, colleges, schools, gaming facilities, public library, airport, amusement park, zoos, nuclear plants, even on the parking lot, you cannot bring it at all. No government buildings. Now, if you go into a parking lot of one of these prohibited places, you can get out of your car, you unload the gun, and then you get out of the car, you can lock it in the trunk or in a locked container in the cab of the vehicle. If you do one of these prohibited activities, it's a $150 fine, and then now for parks and playgrounds, it's prohibited in parks or playgrounds, but you can transit through it, through the walkway to get somebody someplace else. But if you go off the walkway, then you're in violation. Now places who do not, business establishments who do not want concealed carry in their premises, they are required to post a little sign, no firearms allowed. And remember what I said, your mass murders occur in gun-free zones. I gave out a little piece of paper that has some graphics on it. Shows the no firearm sign. If you look at that, there is the picture of the sign that was at the Aurora Theater that showed the Spider-Man film. Okay? Shows a little sign, no guns allowed. So all these stupid law-abiding people in Colorado, okay, I'll obey the law and I'll leave my gun at home, I won't go in. So what he killed, was it 16, 18, something or other? Gun-free zones are dangerous, and that's where all your mass murders occur. So the state of Illinois is creating many more gun-free environments. So where do you think the mass murders in Illinois are going to occur? Northern Illinois University, Virginia Tech, all those places. The mass murders are going to occur in gun-free zones. Now, this HB 183 just passed this concealed carry legislation. It's 168 pages long. And like a third or a half of that deals with mentally defective. How you're supposed to report it and meet certain criteria, they won't allow them to have a concealed carry permit. The Illinois State Police, they must deny or approve your application within 30 days. Now, you may have heard that Governor Quinn had said from the beginning, no, I don't want concealed carry. And the reason he doesn't want concealed carry is because you have some people in a grocery store that are going to bump their carts against each other, and they're going to pull out and have their gun and have a gunfight.
Oh, dear.
Okay. You know what's funny? When I carry in the grocery stores, I'm actually aware of it, and I'm actually more careful, and I realize, okay, I'm going to be very cautious and careful because I don't want any problems. And I'm the one that's carrying, but yet I'm super cautious. People have, of course, a lot of myths and misunderstandings about gun owners like myself. So Governor Quinn, he finally vetoed this legislation, which I knew he was going to. He was going to veto it. And his reasons for vetoing this, which he listed, for one reason, he felt that businesses could post little signs that said no firearms allowed, but private citizens, they wouldn't have that option. Which is silly. Okay? You said I can't criticize the president, but can I criticize the governor?
You can certainly criticize.
Okay, governor, he's so silly. He says
it's only
the
people
silliest
in this
thing.
Room you can't criticize.
In any case, so
that.
Okay, in any case, so Governor Quinn, he vetoed it. One of his reasons was he didn't think private citizens would be able to tell somebody they couldn't have a gun in their house. Are you bloody well kidding me? He actually said that. The reason he said it is because in the legislation, it says if a business does not want a firearm in their place of business, they must post a little sign. But it doesn't say that a person in their home can't post their own sign. It just says it's not mandatory. And not only that, well, who are you going to invite in your home? And will you ask them, hey, we don't want any guns here? No, man, I'm bringing it, and nothing you can do. What? It's silly. It's a silly objection.
Well, do you have to put a sign up there?
What's that? Any case.
You gotta put a sign up or not?
What's the question? In a business?
I love that sound.
In a home.
You have to?
I like the batter chicken.
Yeah. Not understanding what you're saying.
Well, you could save your questions. Okay.
Yeah, I'll take, clarifications. I do want clarifications because I want you to understand this. Okay. You know, an interesting thing about this legislation is a lot of places it's easier not to have a concealed carry permit. Okay? Myself, I use fanny pack carry, okay, this here, okay, because in Illinois law, you can transport your firearm legally, oh, except Chicago, of course, because they're an entity under, so when I say Illinois, it goes without saying I exclude Chicago since they're their own little empire, okay, so Illinois, not to include Chicago, the law says when transporting a firearm, it must be cased and unloaded. Which means you can have a semi-automatic with a magazine, take the gun out, put it in the magazine, cock it, you're good. Okay? So there's a lot of places you can do that where you wouldn't be able to conceal carry. So there isn't that big of an advantage to carry concealed because there's so many prohibited places. Another problem that Governor Quinn had, let's see. He questioned the if businesses or companies, if companies could not prohibit an employee from bringing their firearm on the premises. Okay. Anyways, the way this works, the concealed carry ordinance, is if it isn't prohibited, you can take a firearm to a parking lot. If it is prohibited, right, you would have to unload the firearm in your car and then put it in the trunk or in a locked container in the cab. But Quinn's thinking, oh man, but you know, you go into a business and your company and they don't want firearms on the premises, well, they can't tell you can't. Well, the employee can do the same thing as a prohibited business or government entity, school, whatever. At the parking lot, take it out of the car, put it in the trunk, they can do the same thing there. Businesses or places where you're employed, of course they can prohibit firearms. However, so they would be treated the same as a government entity, a school, or a business. Okay, so there's really no differentiation. Thing is, Governor Quinn, in his wisdom, very intelligent person I found in my years here in Illinois, is... He was trying to think up of reasons. Let's see, what reason can I give to veto this? And he came up with things that really have no meaning whatsoever. So, pardon? All right. I'm ready for questions. That pretty much covers it. The thing's 168 pages long. I told you the criteria. Alcohol, that's another thing that Quinn didn't like. That you can, he doesn't want any firearms around establishments that sell alcohol. Okay? And in fact, personally, I would have constructed such a thing where, fine, carry a firearm wherever, if it's not banned by the local business establishment, but you wouldn't be able to consume alcohol. In this, they're using the same standard that you can consume alcohol, but it would carry the same weight as driving under the influence or impaired driving. Okay, you can't go beyond, I think it is impaired driving, beyond that blood alcohol content. So they do allow you to drink alcohol, but just not so it reaches a legal standard. So that was Quinn's objections, pretty much those three things, which I don't know. I think they're kind of silly. And the thing is, people who have concealed carry permits, they really guard them pretty jealously because they don't want to lose them. And compared to the general population, concealed carry permit holders are much more law-abiding citizens, less likely to get in trouble. And in fact, can you think of a person who had a concealed carry permit who went on a crime spree? You can't. And all these people in Chicago, how many of those people who are shooting each other with firearms had a FOID card or a concealed carry permit or were NRA members? And I would venture to say probably 0.0%. So,
that's not tried in that.
What would you like to ask? Clarification? Right. Are you going to handle it, Bob?
Yeah.
We can get out here early. That doesn't good?
Any more on this?
Isn't area? There's a lot of talk about background checks.
Background checks, yes.
Is getting a FOID card not in effect?
Okay. First of all,
is a background check with a FOID
card. You'll have to have a FOID card, okay? Which I have. Okay. So first of all, you have a FOID card, right? Or you can apply to it, and you. So in addition to the FOID card, you would also have to have the application for concealed carry. So a partial background check is already done with the FOID. You don't need fingerprints with FOID, but with the concealed, this is one of the most severe concealed carry legislation in the United States. Okay, this is the last, number 49 of 50 states, to have a concealed carry permit process. Now Hawaii has one. They'll take your money. Oh, thank you for your contribution, but you'll never get a permit. Okay. So in any case, but with the application for concealed carry, there'll be fingerprinting and a more extensive background check. So it goes without saying. Two DUIs in like 5 years, you're excluded. Have an order of protection against you, you're excluded. All kinds of little things. So it's extensive. I mean, you gotta be pretty darn law-abiding. And like I said, half of this legislation, 168 pages, deals with mentally defective. So you heard about Newtown, you know, they needed to do something about these people who are crazy and shouldn't have guns. Well, this legislation does it in a big way. So.
All right. Yes, Joe Meyer.
I applied to renew my FOID card 3.5 months ago,
yes.
And I have not received it.
Once. Yes. Big backlog. If you know what you need to do, of course, is know a legislator in Illinois, call your congressman, whatever, and let them know. But yes, especially now, there's a real big backlog because everybody wants to get in on this concealed carry. Illinois State Police have always had a big backlog. They never, you know, it's in the law, they must get it to you, what, 2 months, 45, 30 days? That's a ridiculous amount of time. They'll never make that. So yes, they're way behind. And it's in the stack of paperwork. If you call somebody you know, they'll dig in the stack and pull it out. Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions? Yes. Ernie, you have a second question.
Could you comment on the business of not being allowed to take the guns on public transportation? The reason I should tell you why I asked that question, it strikes me as this law gives people who own cars the opportunity to have concealed carry if they want to. I have no intention of buying either way, but it gives people who have cars the opportunity to have concealed carry, but anybody who doesn't have a car cannot, because essentially you can't go anywhere.
First of all, where do all the mass murders occur? Gun-free zones? We can agree on that. Anybody disagree? Go ahead. I'm talking about with firearms. Mass murders.
All mass murders.
You, name one that hasn't. Go ahead.
Waco?
With firearms?
The
they were kind of burned out of the place, yeah. Okay, while you're thinking.
How about the... The federal building in Oklahoma?
Firearms? Mass murders with firearms.
It was fertilizer.
Fertilizer, firearms. They sound alike, but they're different. Yeah,
they're
one was a truck.
Quite the same, no, okay. Right.
Brian, check your audience. I'll check your audience. Anyways, yeah. I'm going to finish this question, then I'll get to you. Okay, Charlie?
Yeah.
Okay.
Charlie?
Mass murders occur in gun-free zones.
Okay.
All right?
Yeah.
So, there was back when Phil Donahue was running his show, he really got on the government to restrict the magazine capacities, semi-automatic weapons, because that occurred during the Long Island Railroad massacre. Okay? Anyway, so he just wanted to kill a bunch of people who are of a different ethnic, it was a race crime. He wanted to kill people who were different than him. So he carried the gun on the Long Island Railroad, pulled it out, and of course started shooting everybody as many as he could. And he didn't have enough practice with the firearm. When he went to reload, he couldn't do it, so they stopped him. As we know, of course, gun-free zone, New York especially, Long Island especially, and on public transportation especially. So my thought on that is you're going to have people who are going to attack others on public transportation knowing that no one else is going to have a gun. It's going to happen. Gun-free zones are target-rich environments. Charlie.
Isn't that because zones that are supposed to be gun-free are those that might be liable to such an event?
Why?
Why? Because they are places where people congregate.
Okay, I'll cover this real quick. Okay.
Such a place.
Yes. He thinks that murders occur in those places because that's where people congregate, right? That's the likely places. Okay, there's the Aurora Theater Massacre. James, whatever his name is, right? The Aurora Theater Massacre. We lived in Colorado. Colorado has a pretty good concealed carry, shell issue. So there's a lot of people that are packing in Colorado. Now, James Holmes, there was a dozen different theaters who were showing Spider-Man that night. He didn't go to the theater that was closest to his house. He didn't go to the theater with the biggest capacity. He went to the theater that had that little sign which is on your desk. That's the actual sign that was at the Aurora Theater. What's it say? No firearms allowed. Why did he pick that theater? Why? Just random?
Why did he say he
I don't know what he did, but why do you think he did? No, I don't know. I have no idea.
I really don't know.
What do you guys think? Why did he pick that theater?
Nobody would have a gun.
Gun-free zone?
Gun-free
what
zone.
Were they showing that night?
Spider-Man.
No, it was Spider-Man.
Yes, it was.
What?
Colorado. Oh, I'm sorry.
Batman?
The Dark Knight. Silly me. The Dark Knight. Excuse me. Yes, Batman.
Charles?
Yeah, Bill, I don't think gun-permitted zones are exactly safe places to be. 9 children die every day in homes where the father or mother brought a gun into the home.
Doubtful.
That makes it very dangerous to be in a...
Doubtful.
Aren't there 10,000 people a year killed in places where guns are permitted?
You make it sound like...
That doesn't seem to be like a very safe place. Homes with guns have gun deaths.
Yeah.
You're going to refute that?
It's irrelevant. What? So,
you
so
said
parents,
gun-free zones?
Yeah.
Gun-permitted
mass murders,
zones?
Mass murders.
Gun-permitted zones
mass murders,
aren't
yeah.
safe.
I would say that they're safer. But you have to look at the statistics of the audience you're talking about in those studies. First of all, children up to age 21 or older, and what kind of households they are. You have to really look at the demographics of it. You show me the demographics.
Kind of people live in the homes?
Yeah, irresponsible people. Different, yeah. All kinds of, if they're irresponsible people, then what? Then also, you know, in California, there's a naked pitchfork-wielding man who broke into a house with, I think it was two girls and a boy. Pitchforked and killed two of the kids. There was a gun in the home. But because of California law, the homeowner locked it up. So the kids, old enough to be able to use it and defend themselves, wasn't able to use it. There's a lot of kids, 12 years old, who defended their house against intruders with firearms. Anyways, it has to do with responsible gun ownership. But you're saying that we'd be a safer society if we didn't have guns? Is that really what you're saying? We'd be safer?
Yeah, I'm telling you, places where there are no guns, people don't get shot, usually.
People where there aren't guns don't get... There weren't any guns in that theater. There aren't any guns on Virginia Tech. That was 32. NIU, what'd they have? Five killed or so? There weren't any guns there. They were real safe places, yeah. Keep the guns out of places like that and we'll be safe. Okay?
Mike Foley.
Okay, so... Why do politicians pass these laws saying who can have a gun, who can't? Where they can take it, where they can't? What kind of gun they can have, why do politicians even pass any kind of laws?
Well, you guys live in Chicago, so you're closer to the reason than I am. I guess they're doing it to keep Chicago safe so no one dies from guns. First of all, this ordinance would never have passed if it weren't for all these exceptions, because the people of Chicago would have voted it down. Personally, it's a lot about control and also not trusting citizens. I trust my fellow citizens more than I do politicians. I think there's more good people than there are bad people. So if everybody has a gun and there's more good people than bad people, who's going to be left standing? That's really my view. I think there's more good people than bad people. Other people making the laws, they tend to think that there's more bad people.
You can bring the check whenever.
The politicians need to protect us from the bad people. Me, you know, let me protect myself. The last thing about that, politicians protecting people, is do you realize that the police have no duty to defend you or protect you?
It's like, what, 19... that the police can't protect them.
Okay, they can't, but they are under no legal obligation to do so. And that was a Washington, D.C. case. Supreme Court adjudicated and said police have no obligation to protect you. So, okay, fine. If you're not going to protect me and don't have to, let me protect myself and people I know personally.
When was that?
David Travis.
I think 87, 86.
My question is manifold. Thank you. Don't you think that the concealed carry is a good step forward for Illinois, one.
Oh yeah. It has too many exceptions.
And that as time goes by, and as the crime rate falls, and as people are murdered in these places where the guns are expressly forbidden, and that people, that certain valorous citizens actually put down criminals, don't you think these restrictions will be altered?
Well, that's proven to be the case. Is Florida was the first state to pass concealed carry, Texas not long afterwards. The thing is start looking at your editorial page, the Trib, Sun-Times. Before these concealed carry ordinances are passed, They always editorialize. It's going to be the wild, wild west. People are going to shoot each other. They're going to bump into carr in a parking lot. They're going to pull out the guns, settle everything there. And it never happens. So yes, when they're proven wrong, more support is given. And this is an interesting thing. A lot of areas, you know, laws become more restrictive. And once they're taken away, it's really hard to get back. But concealed carry, it's like balloon. And a lot of states, in fact, Arizona just went to a more constitutional carry. Meaning, you don't need nothing. You're a law-abiding citizen, you go, you know, do whatever you want with your gun. As long as you don't shoot somebody, that'd be against the law. Vermont, you know, Vermont is a very dangerous place. I don't know if you've been to Vermont. I was there a couple times. Man, I was afraid. Man, people are dangerous there. They have constitutional carry. You don't need nothing. You're a citizen, resident of the state. You carry a gun any way you want, anywhere you want, anyhow. Yeah.
Okay, Bill, question occurs to me with respect to what you're saying about how the application process for this concealed carry thing as the legislation, the 1600 however many pages it was, you made it sound quite arduous, as it were. And I'm wondering, leaving aside the arduousness, but in terms of that your fingerprints and all that sort of stuff, I'm wondering to what extent, if you apply for one of these permits, you're going to, by many multiples, increase the scrutiny of you over just having a FOID card. Would I be correct in making that judgment? I'm talking about being in a database such that if things go a certain way, well, all right, maybe Uncle Sam will decide to come in and march in and confiscate everybody's weapons who's got FOID cards, or will they tend to concentrate their fire, if that's the word, first on the folks with the concealed carry permits?
My opinion is they'll just go after FOID.
You think they'll do that? Okay. So you're not, if you're getting a concealed carry isn't going to put you higher up on the list, as it were.
No, they would just go after the people who have guns.
Okay, period. Okay.
Not saying it would happen or anything.
Joe Mayer had his hand up, and so did Charlie. But, and Ernie, too.
I'll go first.
We'll start with Joe.
Bill, you asked a question before whether we knew of any incident where firearms were permitted and there were mass murders. And I thought of one.
What?
That was an Army psychiatrist at
Fort Hood,
Texas.
Oh, thank you. I'm so glad you brought that up.
Thank you.
I was in the Air Force, and I was also at Fort Drum, New York, okay? I had a concealed carry permit in New York State, but I could not carry a firearm on post because President Clinton issued an executive order that said you cannot carry a firearm on military installations. So it was a gun-free zone. There you go. This is another thing. Quinn, in his wisdom, very intelligent person, always been impressed by his intellect, is he said something about, somewhere I heard somebody said that there needed to be registration of firearms on military installations. Okay, I remember what, it was a letter to the editor, so I'll just cover kind of what you're saying. And said, it would have prevented things like Major Nadal, okay? He could have, first of all, the idiocy of this. Okay, fine, I'm gonna register my guns, and that'll prevent me from killing people with it. Okay, right. Further, I had to register my guns because I lived on post, okay? I chose not to kill anybody, by the way. But see, it excludes people who live off post, which seems reasonable to me. But fine, you register your gun on post or off post. Nadal, he lived off post. So fine, he goes through everything and registers his gun. He went on a jihad suicide mission. He didn't think he was going to come back. Do you think he cared if he registered his guns? Okay.
Bertie? You didn't talk about the statistics of crime and how crime statistics change with concealed carry. Do you have such, do you want to discuss that?
I'll do it quickly. Yes, there's books written about the change in crime statistics, okay? Where concealed carry has passed, murders, rapes, a lot of those crimes go down, okay? You see a trend line like crimes going down anyway, they come down at a faster rate. Florida, big significant crime decrease. You know what's interesting about Florida? I don't know if you remember, there was a time where a lot of rental cars coming from the airport were carjacked. I remember this happening, okay? It was a phenomenon. Why did this happen? Oh, he's got a Hertz rent-a-car sign. He's not from Florida. He doesn't have a gun. So they marked themselves. Hey, I'm not a, you know, not a resident, so I'm fair game. What's your question?
Well, what more on the statistics.
Statistics, right. So anyways, property crime tends to go up a little bit, but crime against persons, that's always gone down consistently. So crime, when concealed carry has been passed, does not go up in those areas.
Property crime goes up a little. Can you theorize?
They have to go somewhere, and they're going to try and find a place without guns, and they don't know who has them, right, in the public and stuff. There's the funniest video. You should write this down. It's Ocala, Florida. Yes, Brom?
Yes, Charlie has the next question.
Great. Okay, Charlie. Okay, you guys should watch this online. It's Ocala, Florida. It's an internet cafe. 72-year-old. For me, I think it's the funniest thing. Okay? So it's an internet cafe, got the computers lined up, you got surveillance video. And there's two different views of the surveillance video, right? Guy comes in with a baseball bat, good old boy, has his semi-automatic, right? Okay, so he's, okay guys, you know, semi-automatic pistol, telling you people got to come here. And then he turns, and a guy about that far away, standing up, he's got, I believe it's a 380 automatic, right? The good old boy made his mistake when he pointed the gun at him. Oh, you're pointing a gun at me? Well, pop, pop, pop. So they're falling over each other, running out of the place. He pops both of them. They lived to be, but I think it's pretty funny. This is a FOID card, okay? So I know you guys in Chicago, it's almost impossible to get one, or you could get one, but you just can't have a gun with it.
Wait.
Yes.
Just a moment.
Oh, Charlie.
Charlie
get,
has the next
please
question.
Remember that. Yes.
All right, Bill, I represent employees in a variety of occupations and all kinds of situations that in the world of work. Do you think employees should be able to bring weapons into the place of employment in their lunchbox or purse or in their
lockers? Well, let's talk about that. Where do all the mass murders occur, Charlie?
I'm asking you seriously.
I'm telling you seriously. Do I think? Do we want a gun-free zone? Do we want the?
Yeah,
we do. Okay.
Fine. I don't.
It's your
know.
Choice.
Do you think people should bring guns?
First of all,
why not?
Okay. First of all, if they have a permit.
I mean, seriously, the whole gun thing largely began with a bunch of shootings in post office.
Yes, you know how you can tell when the post office is hiring?
You know, there were people, employees who got killed.
Yes.
And I've represented people that have been shooting situations with employees I represent. So,
yes.
But do you think if they're...
I heard the question, Charlie. I heard the question. Okay. First of all, these postal employees who shot up their workplace... Were they allowed to carry a firearm in the workplace, or was it prohibited?
As far as I don't know.
Maybe they were prohibited, right? Didn't stop them, did it? So, if you have a permit, okay, you already been checked out. If a person's gonna shoot up a workplace, they're not going to bother with a permit. All these workplace, there has been workplace shootings, a lot of them. And you know why? Gun-free zone. So, okay, that's what we want to create, a place where everybody is vulnerable, you know, helpless. We want to create another place where people are helpless. First of all, if we're working in the same place, Charlie, and somebody gets mad at you, coming to get you, do you want me to have a gun on me or not? Next.
Now, yes, Gene Holman.
Oh, yes, please.
So, I don't understand. Is it legal or illegal to have a gun and a FOID card in your home?
Illinois state law says that to own a firearm, you must have a FOID card. You also have to have one for ammunition. Now, Chicago is really, I love Chicago. You can't have, if you got a 38 revolver, you're illegal if you have a 22 long rifle bullet. Love Chicago.
Wait, but it's legal to have a FOID card and a gun in Chicago.
Theoretically, but try to, anybody, I don't know if anybody wants to admit it, just try it. Theoretically, it is the hardest, lousiest, most expensive procedure. Hardly anyone's gone through the trouble. Yeah, it's legal, but anyone gone through the trouble? Very rare. They made it so hard, it's horrible. They made it real hard.
No, but not before.
Before it was outlawed. That's why Chicago has been such a safe place for the last 20 years, because they outlawed firearms. No one can have a firearm in Chicago. That's why it's safe to be here. Unlike that dangerous place in Vermont. Whew, stay away from Vermont.
All the city councilmen firearm and permits to carry weapons.
Oh, yes, except your elected leaders, they can carry and protect themselves, but yes, you guys aren't important enough.
Yes, sir. My question is, under what circumstances can you see a citizen who is denied the right for concealed carry to sue the political jurisdiction or the location, the state of Illinois, the city of Chicago, for being denied the right to defend themselves?
You're talking about concealed carry?
In any circumstance, in my house, if they prosecute me for defending myself in my home,
right.
Or if I was, suppose I was, okay, example, I have concealed carry and I get on the hill carrying my firearm, and there's some thugs get on the hill and start robbing people.
Right.
And then I pull out and I shoot them or I threaten them, right. I drive them off. Chicago, please come and arrest me.
Yes.
Okay, so given that factual situation, how could I turn around and sue the political jurisdiction for interfering with my right to defend myself?
Well, you know, there's a gentleman named McDonald versus City of Chicago.
He brought
firearms back to Chicago because he sued the City of Chicago, denying him the right to have a firearm to defend himself. So you can go that route. Now, obviously, it's going to be up to the district attorney should they want to prosecute you. But defying Illinois law, unless you have an alderman, that's not going to happen on your side.
Sue,
you're in violation of Chicago or Illinois state law.
Okay, but then at the same time, that's the point.
It's theoretical.
I want to turn it over.
It's so theoretical.
Okay, but not... Right now, it's theoretical because it's not...
Right. No. Find a good lawyer. And there are lawyers who defend gun owners.
Yeah, like Mr. Colisi.
You don't have a right.
Colisi. Like Colisi v. Village of Morton Grove.
Right. And it depends on jurisdiction.
Right.
It's really jurisdiction-driven and your district attorney.
What would interfere? What would be the barrier to me if, given the situation, I have an FOID card, I have a concealed carry permit, I'm in some kind of prohibited parking lot or some prohibited circumstances. I use the gun to defend myself, and I'm not the aggressor.
Personally, you'd probably get off.
Right. Well, okay.
Because you
two things. First of all, there's a law against it, so. If given a factual circumstance where that happens, and there's a law against it, And if they do anything against me, then that triggers my right to fight them in court and then sue them.
Correct? Of course.
And that's what ultimately is going to turn all this stuff over.
It's jurisdiction and district attorney what they want
to
do.
But ultimately, the ability to sue some political jurisdiction for infringing your right to defend yourself is what's going to turn it over.
Where'd you get the right to defend yourself?
It's pre-existing the U.S. Constitution, and it's guaranteed by the Constitution.
All right.
Well, I disagree with you. We could talk about it afterwards if you like.
Just a moment.
Tell me what Constitution you're using.
You challenge the United States Constitution.
Okay, hey, can we cut it?
Okay. We'll talk about it later.
It's not in there.
You're
going to ask your question.
Lee has the next question.
This is a gotcha question. I'll tell you right at the beginning.
Hit me.
Can you name one gun-free zone? The answer is no, you can't, because there's no such thing as a gun-free zone.
Now, what do you say?
The question is, why do you keep talking about gun-free zones and then talk about all the people that got guns in the gun-free zone? If a guy has a gun in a gun-free zone, it's not a gun-free zone.
True, very true.
Now, when you mention the situation about the post office, you said a guy's prohibited from bringing a gun in the post office.
True.
But then you talked about a guy that brought the gun in
That's
the
right.
post office.
That's right.
So why do you say
sense.
It's prohibited to bring a gun in the post office when it's not prohibited? Because
legal.
Anybody can bring a gun into a post office.
Yes.
Anybody can bring a gun into what you call a gun-free zone. So why do you even use the phrase gun-free zone, and why do you say it's prohibited to
yeah.
bring a gun into a post office
yeah.
when it's not?
Yeah. Okay.
Legal.
Thanks for clearing that up.
I didn't clear it up.
I'm going to clear it up. Thank you for allowing me to clear it up. I meant in the legal sense, the legal term of the word.
No, according to the law, anybody can bring in the gun.
According to the law?
Anybody can bring a gun into what you call a gun-free zone.
Really? Have you tried to bring a gun into your local elementary school?
Don't try to turn it on me.
Okay.
Any human being can walk into any school with a
legally?
Gun.
Legally?
What's that got to do with it?
Oh, okay. Thank you. Okay.
Why are you thanking me?
For clearing that
I'm
up?
I'm trying to rip the shit out of you.
I'm sorry, should
That's another question. You only get the one question.
Okay, let me just say the Constitution of the United States, Second Amendment, states a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people, what do they mean by of the people? That's us. The right of the people shall not be infringed. That's what he's talking about. Illinois State Constitution says that we have the... That's what the Constitution said. You can interpret, but that's what it says.
It's an army.
You're wrong.
I gave a lecture last
year.
Well, you're wrong. Your lecture was wrong.
Reclaiming my time. You can come up here afterwards. Is the Supreme Court, by the way, disagreed with you in two court cases. So you might be more intelligent or important than them, but the Supreme Court of the United States ruled that it is an individual right. So it's been settled.
That's your answer. Okay.
If we can back up 5 minutes or so, Bill, you made
much
a comment.
As you want.
Yeah, you do. You made a comment to the effect of that you need one FOID card for weapons, but then a different FOID card for ammo.
I'm saying you must have a FOID card for ammunition and for a firearm.
The same card.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
All right. Dave Travis.
I'd just like to clear up one thing concerning the question that Mr. Foley had presented about gun-free zones and that sort of thing. When I was a little boy in grammar school,
is this a question?
It was against the rules to bring candy to class.
Okay.
And if they caught you with it, they made you put it in a wastebasket.
Okay.
Well, there were those of us who always brought candy.
Well, I hope you ate it before you put it in the wasteland.
This is a question period.
Here, Joe Mayer.
Not anecdote period.
The Illinois State Police, by the way, I'll say their constitution says that the right of the people kind of keep and bear arms, subject to police powers, I believe. And Chicago really took that to heart.
right, Joe.
I have no question.
Oh. Like,
you hurt my feelings.
Andy.
Help the Anderson.
Bill, I have a question. At what point did these general mass murders begin in America? I don't remember reading much about it in our history books, in the early history, like what's happening in our schools now. You know, people have always had guns, but we haven't had people going off the rails and killing children like what we're seeing in the last couple of decades. What's your opinion on why these things are happening in America rather than other countries?
Well, two things. Break up the family and also schools lost discipline. If you look at the record of the people who've committed these mass murders, you know, what, 9.9 out of 10 times, it's a mentally disturbed person. You just look at it. And people around them knew. In fact, the Aurora theater killer, he was in college, and people around him, man, I don't want to be next to that person. That guy's weird. He's going to go off. People knew that they had mental problems, but nothing was ever done. Personally, breakup of a family, loss of discipline, and lack of standards in the school.
What do you think our country can do?
It's kind of late now. What can we do? You really can't go back. Okay, schools, we're going to do things differently. We're going to kick out all the troublemakers and are we going to put more people in institutions? It's a hard fight.
No. All right, Charles, another question.
Yeah, Bill, do you think public safety is an inherent function of government?
I think it should be, but they don't.
Your alleged right to personal safety is more important than the community.
More important than the community. You have things called natural laws. And what they say one of the natural laws is the right to self-defense.
Wait, what's natural law?
I just explained it to you. Meaning God-given. God-given.
Define the natural law.
Okay, I'll define it. It means that it comes through by birth, by being a person, a human. It comes outside the scope of any legislative body, any state, any government entity.
So something you made up.
Okay, fine, something I made up. So it's known or suggested that a natural right is the right to self-defense. So that takes precedence over pretty much anything else.
Public safety doesn't matter.
How am I protecting myself from danger to public safety?
Is personal safety more important than the safety of the community or public safety?
The safety.
Well, I don't know. It depends which country you live in. Soviet Union, North Korea, not so much. In the United States, we've always wanted to protect the rights of the individuals. We're individual-driven, not group rights. But I don't see how disarming, I don't know. You know something?
Disarming?
You guys in Chicago have done it right. You've disarmed all of you. None of you own guns. And man, you're the safest city in the United States. You guys know how to protect the community. Good job. Carry on.
Do I understand, you seem to have implied that this House Bill 183, if and when it becomes law,
it will.
Will not apply to Chicago?
No, they had to concede a lot of things to get it passed and get through Chicago. But that's another interesting thing. My understanding is that this new legislation will override current Chicago.
That's what it's
I'm not sure if Chicago will continue to be able to go through the permitting process with this in force. I'm a little fuzzy. I thought this supersedes it. Because one thing they did insist upon this law was preemption. Right? Because if they didn't have preemption, you know, every county and city in Illinois would have their own little lousy law. So you drive through a place, hey, you got a firearm on you? Oh, it's not permitted in this town. So this has a preemption. Now, what they did do, this was passed a while ago, and it took them a long time to pass it. And they've been stringing it out for as long as they could. Lisa Madigan appealed this thing or put up a submission for an appeal. Quinn waited to the last minute to veto this, and now it has to be overridden. The reason they did all this delays, because in the legislation, local municipalities have 10 days after it's passed to put in their own little restrictions, mostly just dealing with assault weapons, which the city of Skokie just did. You cannot, it is now illegal to have an assault weapon in the city of Skokie. If you have one, you're in violation. Boom, just like that.
I have a question that is a bit hypothetical, but given all these people with concealed carry permits and so on, suppose you have one of your crowded theaters or whatever, and somebody comes in and shoots somebody else. There.
Okay, so they're liable.
They have a gun and they're shooting. Then other people there who have their concealed carry permits on their and their guns get up and start shooting at people who have guns and are shooting. Where does it end? It looks like mayhem and murder. Mass shootings.
Mm-hmm.
Or in the dark movie theater, too. Yeah. Wow, movie theater or whatever.
Okay, I guess it worked out better that nobody had a gun, except the shooter. I guess that was the best choice. You know, this happened in Charlie Square Mall.
Well, it doesn't. You don't know. The shooter might be shooting at one person, or the shooter might be shooting at...
Right, you asked your question.
Or anybody who has a gun, who they...
Okay, you're going to ask a third time? Go ahead.
As a threat.
You're going to ask a fourth time?
Well, that's the question.
Okay, great. In any case, so some people think that it was better that only the murderer had a gun, and that worked out okay.
No.
Okay, now I'm going to cover it, if you let me. I'm covered if you let me. Well, patience. All right. People don't understand gun owners and people who have guns. We're really a lot smarter than people give us credit for. Trolley Square Mall, Salt Lake City, Utah. A guy came in with shotgun, started shooting up the place. Okay. Obviously, this was a very safe place because they had a little sign that said no firearms allowed. Where do all mass murders occur? Gun-free zones in the legal sense. So, there was an off-duty cop from Ogden. He wasn't allowed to carry in Utah, in Salt Lake, but he was. So he tracked down this guy, civilian clothes, and then the Salt Lake City cops came up. Did they shoot this guy with a gun in civilian clothes? No, they were like, okay, right, he's one of us, the way he was approaching things. And they worked together to corner the shooter and took him down, okay? Now, the interesting thing about the movie theater, you're thinking the darkness, oh no, you can't see him, and that's like bad, right?
No, not necessarily.
First of all, it works both ways. That means you're concealed. And guess what?
It works.
You.
Come on, can you let him answer the question?
One fool at a time.
Nonsense.
He's a moderator.
Well, you're putting words in my mouth.
Well, yeah.
Okay, how did I misunderstand you? I'm answering his question. I'm covering the entire thing if you let me. And if I don't cover something, let me know. No, you didn't cover it. But I'll try to cover it. All right, fine. The darkness in a dark theater works both ways. You think only the good people are blind, but the bad guy, he can see everything. But no, I can't see him, the theater's dark. What? Which means me as the good guy, I'll say I'm the good guy, just for purposes of illustration. I have the advantage of surprise. He doesn't know I have a gun, and he doesn't know where I am. And I can sit down underneath a seat. The thing is, once I use my first shot, guess what? He's not out murdering anybody else. Now he's got to worry about somebody shooting back at him. So I've stopped that mass murder just by shooting once. Geez, where'd that come from? You know, he's worried about, now he's worried about self-preservation. He's worried about me. And you say there's multiple shooters? Like I said, us gun owners are not that stupid. We see some, first of all, a guy shooting up the place. Oh, there's another guy with a gun. I'm not going to worry about that guy shooting up the place. I'm going to shoot at that other guy with, what? Come on, we're not that stupid. We know who the bad guy is, and that's who we're all going at. If there's one shooter in, if there's another guy with a gun in that theater, I would say 50-50 chance it would have ended. We would have taken out. Two guys with guns, 90% chance we would have taken them out and stopped it. But unfortunately, all those law-abiding citizens, they were so law-abiding. Well, I don't want to break the law, so I won't bring my gun in the theater. By the way, if places like that, if you violate the little sign that says no guns allowed, they would ask you to leave. And you, oh, okay, fine, cool. And there is no punishment or penalty. So someone could have done it. Now I'll guarantee you a lot of people are doing it and just hiding the thing. But if they're in violation, they would just be asked to leave. Okay, fine, cool. And that would be the end of it. Any other, what didn't I cover? We could have taken them out.
Yes, Andy?
I haven't heard anything talked about tonight about possible screening. As my question is, I got two questions. Quick, I mean, it's the same thing.
Screening for permits?
Okay, no. In a theater, why not have one or two armed guards in a theater to protect people rather than everybody, you know, being, you know, number one, wouldn't armed guards help? Like, the Israelis have armed guards on all their planes.
Of course.
And the second thing I would say is, why not walk through a metal detector? Like you have, a lot of schools already have in the first place. They detect most kinds of guns. You know, the plastic ones, they won't. Well, the new detectors are more sophisticated, right? They'll sense bullets.
Well, first of all, they're really plastic guns. Okay, they're Glocks, you know, the
they
call only the
plastic,
frame is plastic, but there's a lot of metal on it.
Yeah.
No, a metal detector would not get through, or let them get through. In any case, but what are you... Are you asking? I got it.
Doorway detectors are cheap now. They come down way down
got
the
it.
Price.
Got your question.
Compared, my question is, why aren't you advocating?
Aren't I advocating?
Why not advocate if you're trying to make society safer so less people get killed? Why not advocate to make safer conditions rather than advocate to let everybody carry a gun concealed? That's my question.
We've tried to make everything as safe as we can, okay? Now, James Holmes, say that theater had metal detectors, right? You know how he got his guns? Do you know?
No.
Okay, fine. He went into the theater, bought a ticket. He went out the emergency exit, propped it open, went out to his car and brought his stuff in. People are always going to bring stuff in. People are cunning. When they're out on a mission, they will find a way. And a metal detector? Is that going to stop somebody with a gun? Pow! Okay. No more metal detector. What? Okay, there's a metal detector at the Capitol building. Guy shot his way into there. Armed guards right there at the entrance. Shot his way into the Capitol. Okay? If there are two guys, he probably would have they would have done a lot of damage. But only one guy, he was eventually shot by security. But why don't I advocate? Well, I'm not into telling private businesses what to do. Are you saying we should legislate? Hey guys, theaters got to have armed guards, got to have a metal detector. You know, I'm not into telling private businesses what to do. Furthermore, it gives you a false sense of security because they will always get through if they want to.
That's it.
If your gun-free zones are where the mass murders occur, make it gun-free. It's where the murders are going to occur.
Finish. Mike Foley.
A lot of people, maybe you included, maybe not. I don't know. But a lot of people think got to have laws that say this about who can have a gun and who can't have a gun because it will stop all this killing and everything, and too many people are getting killed with guns and blah blah blah. Why doesn't the government just pass a law against murder?
I think most states have that.
Wouldn't that stop a lot of killing?
I think Chicago has that law.
Wouldn't people obey that law and never kill anybody?
Perhaps.
Perhaps not.
Forcing it or trying to.
Oh, was that a question? Why don't they? Yeah, I agree they should. My answer is they should. Yes, Chicago definitely should, because they got a problem with that. I don't know why they didn't pass that years ago. Next.
But I know he was going
to... I don't expect your sarcasm. I'm asking a reasonable, simple question.
Be
answer the question or tell me to shut up.
All right. Well, I'm sorry. The question was, why don't they pass a law against murder? Yeah. And I said they should. What more? I'm sorry. What more do you want? That's my answer. That's my answer.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions? Or yes, Gene Harker.
This is a little bit off the topic, but I saw a movie that claimed that Canada had about as many guns as the United States, but Canada had less murders.
Canada has less murder rate than the United States, yes, as other places. Demographics. Mostly dealing with demographics. It ain't the guns, because we know Chicago doesn't have any, and yet last year they had over 500 murders. So it ain't the guns cause. I don't know what's killing people in Chicago, but it ain't the guns.
That's why they passed the law, because there are guns. Okay.
Thank you.
Yes.
It's the guns.
Yeah, this is over here. We have law enforcement officers in the city of Chicago and the state of Illinois, and I'm really wondering, we didn't deputize all these guys. I see these gun owners, and I don't think we should be enforcing the laws of the city of Chicago or the state of Illinois, what they think. I mean, I just heard some nonsensical interpretation of the law, and you gave me law that exists only in your head and your heart, perhaps. And you're going to bring a weapon out and enforce something called made-up laws.
Okay.
Do you think this is something we should logically do? Is deputize and give weapons and authority to these people?
It's a lot of money. But
I mean, you just gave me something called
made-up
law. I don't know what in the world that is.
I know. You can look it up on the internet.
It's not by the state of Illinois.
No, you can find it on the internet. In any case, if you want definition.
Goes back to John Locke.
I'm sorry, the question was?
At least.
Was there a question?
Do you think we should
deputize people?
Yeah, don't we have law enforcement personnel?
And you think there's enough? Okay,
well,
up to you. You live in Chicago, you know, hey. Yeah.
All these gun guys, I don't know if we...
He asked my opinion, I said, yeah, this answer. Andy.
I don't think anybody has asked is there a distinction between, you know, if you're talking about concealed carry and what should be legal to conceal carry, is there a difference between a standard handgun, more or less, with, you know, 10-round magazine and something, an assault weapon that holds 20 or 30 rounds or more?
First of all, it's hard to define assault weapon. And the number of bullets does not an assault weapon make. I'm glad you pointed that out, because another one of Governor Quinn's objections...
They're talking about that, that's why I asked.
...is veto, exactly right, of who I have the greatest respect for his high intellect. He did want concealed carry people to only be allowed 10 bullets. Okay? And to your question, I guess, is there is no limitation on the type of firearm. The thing is, it's going to have to be a pistol, because you can't carry concealed a rifle, you know, really. You've got a big old trench coat in the summer. So anyway, there is not a restriction on the type of firearm for concealed carry.
Okay.
Was that what you asked?
Yeah, I wanted, you know, there are
no rounds or
capacity. They're talking
about
trying to regulate these rapid fire things that can fire 30 or 40 bullets in a few seconds. And,
okay.
Yeah, and those aren't, you know, for self-defense. Those are made to kill people in a massive hurry.
Let me think on this. They're not for self-defense. They're only for kids. So you can't defend yourself with one. So that's what you're saying?
No, that's not what I'm saying at all. I'm saying you can defend yourself really well with some kind of concealed revolver.
You can't with a rifle.
You don't need something that'll spray bullets all over the
right.
place.
In any case, you have big magazines in pistols that'll hold a lot of rounds too. But no, there is no limitation on the type of ammunition or whatever.
You can kill as many as you want.
Laws as they apply to police. Don't most policemen take their weapons with them home, and is that, or have it on them most of the time, and is that legal or illegal? Or against
that's my understanding, but that's local ordinance.
Okay.
It's local ordinance.
But the police normally do have weapons on them, even when they're off duty.
Some departments require it, and some don't.
Does Chicago require it?
I'm not a resident here.
No. Okay. So the same people asking questions. All right, Mike Foley, but unless we have somebody who hasn't asked a question, I am going to suggest that maybe we want to move to the rebuttal period.
We got to
ask
this
question.
All right,
go ahead. Yeah, going back to your gun-free zones.
Yeah.
Talk about all these government buildings downtown are gun-free zones.
Yes.
They're full of guns.
I'm sorry.
They got police officers with guns in the building.
You're right, I was wrong.
They got Cook County Deputy Sheriffs with guns in the building.
You're right, I was wrong.
They got state police with guns in the building.
You're right.
They got FBI agents with guns.
Yes, they do.
How come you can have all these law enforcement officers bringing the guns into the gun-free zone? What's so special about them?
Deputized, approved by the state.
So what? A gun is a gun. Okay. Why can they bring a gun into a gun-free zone?
By law, they're authorized.
Why? It's a simple question.
Why?
By law.
Free of why pass the law? Who passed the law?
Legally free of guns. So
fuckers that
cover guns.
You wouldn't
have all right, let's...
All right. All right, how many people here have remarks to make on this subject or whatever subject to the rest of us? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. All right, well... We'll start off with 5 minutes, and then...
Oh, we got an hour and a half left.
Yeah, I know.
We'll
start off... Well, you want to make it 6. Who's going to keep the time on this?
I can do that.
Paul Rossino will keep the time. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right.
I got my gun.
Thank you, Paul. Paul, by the way, is recording our
my gun thing
affairs here. If you have any exceptions to being photographed, tell Paul about it, and he will try to oblige you.
All right, let's thank our speaker. Yay!
By the way, you know that you've been here before. You have the final
information.
All right. First, Joe Mayer.
No, ma'am. It's the truth. I'm sorry.
Carry on. I want to thank our speaker, Joel, for a wonderful presentation on a very, very sensitive subject. And I'm sure that the public really doesn't understand what's at stake here. Although I've seen statistics for the state of Illinois where the majority of those who were asked favored concealed carry, as they are in many other states, all 49 of the states. I have here 2 unloaded dueling pistols for those of you who would like to challenge our speaker later in the day. But the question I have, not the question, it's a position I have. In some of our communities, in some of which I have lived in, there's an initiation process where you, as a member of a local gang, you must shoot somebody, preferably to wound or kill them.
And if you do that, then you are able to join, you are a certified member of the gang. Now, this is an interesting subject because it sounds to me like it's a terrorist act against the innocent citizens of the community, and certainly the United States.
Against the police, Joe.
And against the police, thank you. Now, we have gone to war in Afghanistan and other places in order to deal with terrorists. Would it be asking too much for the Army, the Navy, the Marines, the drones to locate those hotspots where these terrorists, gang members, certified gang members live, and eliminate them? I mean, shoot to kill type situation. It would certainly give a military aura to the entire community, maybe the whole country, but it would certainly eliminate the gangs, right? No, it wouldn't, but that's the way it has to be done.
Mike Foley.
Hello, I'm Michael Foley. I'm just wondering, is Charlie still here? Is Charlie still here?
He stepped away.
Maybe he went out for cigarette.
Yes.
Well, he's lucky I'm here. Every once in a while, I got to straighten him out. Anyway, this thing about right to self-defense came up in the conversation. Oh, excuse me. I was listening to a radio show, I don't know, about a year ago or something like that. Some guy mentioned that the right of self-defense, the right of a person to defend himself against attack, is a right that has been acknowledged by every society and every government and every religion that has ever existed. I don't know if that's correct or not, but it sounds reasonable. Also, Charlie's always asking his, oh, there he is.
Yeah.
Charlie, I'm here to straighten you out.
Oh, nice.
I said, I was listening to a radio station about a year ago, so anyway, some guy said that the right of self-defense is a right that has existed, has been acknowledged by every society, every religion, every government that has ever existed. Also, Charlie always likes to ask that question, you show me where the Constitution is saying you can do this, do that. Once you have some poor woman, where does it say in the Constitution you have a right to buy an automobile, for God's sakes? Anyway, well, why the hell did you ask her then? The right to self-defense is mentioned in the Declaration of Independence. It's inherent in the thing about people have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Oh,
the right to self-defense is part of the right to life. Now, as far as concealed carry, we have a concealed carry law in Chicago and in the state of Illinois, and we always have had a concealed carry law in Chicago and the state of Illinois. The law says any criminal can have any kind of gun and can carry it anywhere they want, anytime they want. That is what the law is in the state of Illinois and the state of Chicago. Any criminal can have any kind of gun, pistol, rifle, can have a machine gun, can have a rocket, hand grenades, mortars, plastic explosives, bombs. Any criminal can have any of that stuff. Anytime they want, anywhere they want. That's the law. Now, I'm opposed to concealed carry. I think if somebody's going to walk around in public with a gun, they should have it exposed, have it visible. Carry it in their hand, carry it in their holster. If you got a rifle slinging on your shoulder, or a shotgun, if you got a machine gun and want to walk around with it slung on your shoulder, holding it real John Wayne style or something. But I believe that anybody who is outside of their house, or off private property anyway, anybody that's out in public who has a gun should have it exposed. Now, if that is the way things were in our society, you would be amazed how polite our society would be. You wouldn't have people saying, hey, up yours, F you. You wouldn't have people shoving their way out of the way, shoving guys out of the way. If half the people walking around in public had a gun in their hand, we would have a very polite society. Now, I'm not joking about that either. This concealed carry stuff is BS. What if you're walking around and you're wondering? See some thug hanging on the corner. Now, he could also still have a gun in his pocket, but it'd be a lot better if we knew who had the guns and could see who had the guns. And if somebody gave you a hard time, just blast his ass, that's all. Be done with it. If somebody's walking around in a society where half the people got guns and he's acting like a jerk and an idiot, the guy's asking, the guy's committing suicide is what he's doing. He's asking to be shot to death. So shoot him to death. I'm not joking, I'm serious about this. Now, tonight's fairy tale. Like a lot of the BS we hear from politicians, we heard it from Bill B. The language they use, the phrases they use, is BS on top of BS. He might as well be standing up here saying, Snow White was walking down the path in the forest, and she met Prince Charming. Prince Charming took her to the castle, blah, blah, blah. Bill Lee talks about gun-free zones. There is no such thing, they do not exist. This restaurant is not a gun-free zone. Buses are not a gun-free zone. Red Line train, taverns, stores, you go downtown, you go to Kmart, you go to Target, it is not a gun-free zone. You go into any school in this country, it is not a gun-free zone. Because any criminal can walk in there with a gun. They don't have some kind of magic gadget over the door. Some guy's walking in, he's got a gun tucked in his shirt, and all of a sudden he walks in and zap! The gun vaporizes and the bullets vaporize. And they're just little wisps of smoke. That don't happen. A criminal can carry a gun anywhere he wants. A criminal can take a gun into any school, hospital. A criminal can walk into a police station and start shooting police officers if he wants. That's why they call them criminals. There is no such thing as a gun-free zone. It's a fairy tale.
Time.
I should have stayed home. I know.
Okay, the other thing.
Time.
About
time.
About assault weapon. That's another fairy tale phrase. Your fist is an assault weapon. Your foot is an assault weapon. A meat cleaver or a butcher knife is an assault weapon. Okay, thanks. I'm sorry I went away.
All right, very good. You guys.
I'm sorry, sir. Thank you.
No, I know they're nuts.
Well, during the Revolutionary War, there was a saying that for lack of a nail, the shoe was lost. For lack of the shoe, the horse was lost. For lack of the horse, the soldier was lost. For lack of the soldier, the battle was lost. For the lack of the battle, the war was lost. Well, also in those days they said that to truly have an independent nation, that a nation is a magnification of all of its citizens, and so to be independent, that the people need to be independent. So I want to mention that in Yellowstone Park, there were bears that would beg people for food and would raid the garbage cans. And the bears degenerated into a being kind of like a bunch of winos that would fight with each other over garbage from the garbage cans. A very smart and clever individual who came in to run the place put in a type of garbage can that they couldn't get into and imposed very large fines on people who would give the bears any food. So the bears were forced to go back to their old ways where they would climb trees and get honeycombs and they would go and catch fish and so forth and eat. And the bears became hardy again, and a proud group, a proud species. And so what I want to say here is that in order to have a good citizenry in this country, a good, hardy, strong citizenry, remember that a nation is a magnification of its individuals, as I've already said, that the people need to be given responsibilities. Having a gun is a responsibility. If people can, if they carry guns, if they have guns, and they can defend themselves, then people will be a more responsible citizenry and a great country again. If we continue to have authority figures to be shepherding the people, then we'll only have a weak and inept citizenry, and we won't ever be strong like we once were. And so let's not lose our freedom as a nation for the lack of guns.
Single count.
Thank you.
Okay. You're going 7 minutes tonight?
Six. This is fine.
Okay.
Thank the speaker. Made me think a bit, and I appreciate you coming in at the last moment. While I was sitting there, I remembered, now I'll have to, you know, this is memory, so I may be wrong. Brahm or Charlie or Don might remember this. For some reason, one of our regulars came in with a huge sword and pulled that out and waved it around and put it back. There was no danger at all. But I saw one lady run out the back way. So that was the only weapon that I saw here at the College of Complexes. I personally would not, you know, when I was 18 years old, or maybe up to 26, I was in the National Guard, so I had to carry an M1. I think I was more in danger than anyone else with that in my hand. I haven't had a weapon in my hand since then. I wouldn't trust myself with one. I can't see, can't hear, and I don't trust my anger. Sometimes I get very, very angry. I never had a problem with that, but I'm not going to put it to the test by having a weapon. Thank you.
All right. Again, I'd like to thank our speaker for kicking this around here, and good luck on your campaign. I thought maybe you could talk later about your campaign for office. Anyhow, I'm going to be eclectic as usual here. Thinking you're going to go to some issues. Obviously, I represent employees. And what happens are, on occasion, people get fired. It's a common practice among employers not to announce in advance. They usually give a proposal, but the final decision to fire somebody up isn't given advance notice. However, they will have a meeting in which two guards are in attendance, and they will help you clean out your desk, locker, what have you, and escort you from the property.
After collecting the keys in the washroom.
Right. The point I'm making is I have certain reservations about permitting weaponry in places of employment. I'm not too certain that people should be bringing weaponry in their lunch boxes or lunch pail, keeping it in their lockers or in their briefcases or purses. Another thing, we went over here a little bit about, I heard some, as usual in this discussion about gun control, some things, wild interpretations of the Constitution. The only rights you have are the rights that are enumerated by laws and spoken of. Now, in my unlimited world, I deal with the administration of contracts. And on occasion, we have hearings before an arbiter on contract language. And I assure you that in such hearings, we are restricted to the language that is actually in the contract. And you guys come along with this gun stuff, and you are literally off in outer space with your things you come up with. You have to stick, John would tell you this, you've got to stick to the language that's there. They go, I actually go phrase by phrase. And if I brought something, yes, sundry things from outer space, I would just, there would be objections raised and say, I think we need to take a break because Mr. Paddock appears to be intoxicated. But enough of that. I represent employees who carry weaponries. I've had things like shooting it in locker rooms, even supposedly trained people. I even made an effort in concert with other union representatives to have, and talking about you, Joe, employees disarmed who are authorized to carry weaponry because we thought it was of no benefit either to themselves or their coworkers. Let's see, I don't get into it. Now, the basic thing you kept harping on, I wouldn't say harping, I'm discussing here, is that gun-free zones are dangerous. Now, you could flip that around, and you use logic, and that, therefore, gun-permitted zones are safe. Now, is your basic premise that a gun-permitted zone, such as the street at midnight, where I'll be later, is safer than the gun-free zone of my home? If you bring weapons into a home, you do not, from my perspective and statistically, you do not enhance the safety of that dwelling. Only 1% of the weapons, the incidences in which weapons are used in the United States, less than 1% or less, are used in self-defense. 99% of those are accidents, homicides, and suicides. So I don't know what you're achieving here. You're not enhancing. Now, the other issue is public safety. Anytime I hear a pronouncement of rights, I put on a conference on the Human Declaration of Human Rights. There's these pronouncements, my right to this, and I have the right to personal safety. Well, there's always another right out there that you're countervailing the right there. As your personal safety is obviously not important than the public safety. And public safety is an inherent function of government. If you like, go to read John Locke. And that's what we put together this country here, and your personal safety. And that's spurious. We're trading off your right. Your personal safety is superior to that. I'm more important than the community. This is what you're saying. Does that mean to expect to support that? No, I don't believe that. I'm sorry. That's where your libertarian arguments fall apart. Now, there's another thing out there. The mayors of the United States, at least 950 of them that I last read, have gotten together and want gun control. These administrators of municipalities, and I think that's quite a lot of people, and that's quite a lot of people that see there's problems in our cities. And it's not going to be solved by disseminating, giving weapons to everyone. Okay, we covered that. Let's see. And the last of all, and where's Andy? Oh, he left.
He's here.
Oh, you're entirely correct. No, I was looking here, doing a little research here, and I see this assault weapon. They got an AK-47 for sale with a clip of 75 rounds. Now, you're telling me you need something like this for self-defense? What kind of enemies do you have?
I'm going to
a brigade of commies or what, you know? You need a round. It was an AK-47 with a clip like this. I'm going, well, that's an awful lot of firepower, you know. And last of all least, I've always got to talk about my loony neighbor. Now, if you think giving my loony neighbor weaponry and enhances my life, I'm sorry it doesn't. On occasion, my cat likes to go for a walk, which necessitates that I go out and retrieve him. And my loony neighbor, I'm always thinking, is out there as well, protecting his purse, his castle doctrine, and his personal safety. while I'm doing nothing more than trying to retrieve my little cat, Alston. But anyhow, thanks a lot, and I know you can pick this apart, but hope to see you again when you're running on your campaign.
Thank you.
Bill, thank you for a great talk. You obviously are well psychologically put together to deal with this very obstreperous crowd here. You handled some of the problems very, very well. And you brought up the point about gun-free zones as being where most of the, at least of the mass murders, not necessarily the individual murders, take place. That's a good point. I think there are two main reasons that we should have concealed carry. It's about time. And I don't think either of them have anything to do with the Second Amendment. The first reason is the basic inherent right, call it a natural right, whatever, you can probably find it in the law and constitution, to protect oneself and one's family, okay? The police are only minutes away when seconds count, and the police would try and help whether they have to or not, but they can't always do it. The best way is to protect yourself. And the second and probably more important reason, which we just touched on tonight, is places that have concealed carry, crime goes down. As soon as concealed carry law is in, crime goes down. This is a fact, and people who are anti-gun just don't want to look at that, but it is a fact. John Lott came up with studies years ago on this. He said that it reduced crime 13 to 15%. The newer studies, I was always a little suspicious of those studies. The newer studies are showing 30 to 45% crime goes down in areas as soon as the concealed carry goes in. Why? Because the criminals then don't know who has a gun. They know, as was pointed out, in a so-called a gun-free zone that nobody has a gun. But they don't know in areas where concealed carry is law. As it turns out, only about 2 to 4% of the people who are eligible to get weapons under new concealed carry laws actually do so. But that's enough to be a deterrent to criminals, and that's why property crime goes up, because the criminals have to make their living some way. Like if they can't do it mugging people, or if they're scared to do it mugging people, then they won't do it. This is why in this country we have less what's called hot burglaries. In other words, burglars going into a place even knowing that the occupants are there. In other countries where they have stricter gun laws and people don't have guns, they have a much higher number of hot burglaries. And as far as HB 183, we do need it. The Chicago and a lot of Illinois politicians have a blind spot, especially our former mayor Richard M. Daley, in many ways good people, but they have a blind spot on this. They have a hatred, a fear of guns, which is irrational. And they've been fighting this for years, spending the taxpayers' money to fight the Supreme Court of the United States, and it's about time we had something. However, this law, if you look at it carefully, is basically a law that's written by people who don't want there to be concealed carry laws. There are so many restrictions and so many items in there, they're effectively poison pills, which make the law pretty tame. About the only thing you can do is take the gun, put it in your car, and leave it in your car when you drive around. Or you can walk around your neighborhood with your concealed weapon if you have the proper permit, but you can't go anywhere. Okay, you can't go to libraries, public buildings, you can't go to most stores if they don't want you to go in. You can't go anywhere, basically. And therefore, what are you gonna do? If you leave your house to go somewhere, you're usually gonna do something. You're gonna go shopping, you're gonna go to City Hall to pay some taxes or something like that. You can't do any of that if you have your concealed weapon unless you leave it in the car. And what about folks like myself who don't have a car, okay? This is an elitist bill. It allows some freedom of having a concealed weapon to people who have a car, but to those of us who don't, we essentially, it's moot, because if you can't carry it on public transportation, you can't carry it anyway. And as far as I'm concerned, if you pass the test, the FOID test and the further background check, that is what says you're a reasonably reliable person. You should be able to carry a weapon. If you can carry it in the street,
why can't you carry it into some of these other locations? It's a silly rule, and it's as I say, I think it's a poison pill, which will cause the law to be challenged again. So we'll go through this whole process again until finally we get a decent law. And I don't know what states have better laws. Maybe our speaker could comment on that. He has to a little extent. And I have a comment here for Charlie regarding Halstead. You know, there was a case a few years ago where a dog jumped on his owner's shotgun and blasted his owner in the butt. Okay. Well, we all know cats are at least as smart as dogs. If a dog can learn to handle a gun, Halstead should certainly be able to handle a gun. So just get him a 38. So he goes over to the neighbor's place, you know, and somebody's saying, "Oh, nice kitty, nice kitty, nice kitty." Boom! You know, and that takes care of your loony neighbor right there. Thank you.
Six minutes?
Six. Hi, my name is L.P. Anderson, and I'd like to make a couple of comments that I, you know, touch on something that people haven't talked about here tonight so much. I think, well, in 1975, on the Tom Snyder Show, I was in Kentucky with my father. He was retired, and we were just listening to a late-night show. And Tom Snyder had six of the police chiefs from around the country, from six major cities. Did you ever see that program or a reprint? Anyway, they were talking about the kids growing up then, 5, 6, 7, 8 years old. This is 1975. They said, the way these kids are being raised and their families are treating them like they have no more value than the television set or something else. These kids are growing up, they will be a generation of criminals unlike anything the world has ever seen. And there was something in the newspaper, you know, a few years ago about a kid that pushed his younger brother out the seven-story window to see if he would fall and die. Just curious. Push him down the stairs to see what happens. Part of the problem we're having with the violence in America is the way kids are being raised and the respect for law. I mentioned a book, there's a book called The Sociopath Next Door that written by a woman, I think it was Martha Stout. She published this book in 2005. Her thesis is 1 in 25 people are sociopaths, basically no ethics, no morals, and no conscience, right?
Right.
And you might disagree about whether it's 3% of the population or 5% or 1 in 10. Some people think it's 50%, but I go with her 4%, 1 in 25. But anyway, our society is seeing the results. If you allow people with sociopathic tendencies to rise to the top and get in positions of real power, and get in, if they become billionaires, they inherit money, and you allow sociopathic sharks to run wild, the country has big, big, big problems. And the Censored News, the award-winning program out of Sonoma State that publishes a book every year on the top 25 blacked out stories that would change our country overnight if they were covered rather than blacked out, from 2006 to 2011, those 5 years of Censored News, they had a whole section in that book about crimes of politicians, high-ranking people, and especially the crimes of the people that orchestrated and created the myth of 9/11 and had the power to control the press so that the press has been continually selling us the myth. There's thousands of scientists all over the world, and many in our country too, that believe the myth of 9/11 is the dark energy, the dark force that's driving a lot of bad things that are happening in America. If we puncture that myth and realize that we weren't attacked by Muslims that hate us from oil-rich countries, just puncture the myth and realize that there is no huge terrorist network out there killing Americans. Fewer Americans die at the hands of terrorists every year than die in bathtub accidents. So they're, the numbers are minuscule. The at current prices today, at current prices as of the outdoor fair in Wisconsin 2 weeks ago, there's several companies are selling the new modern solar panels that are made in America. Solar and wind power today is vastly cheaper than foreign oil from any country. And that's common knowledge among the analysts from a lot of different countries that are converting their countries and their energy policies to solar and wind power as fast as possible. Australia has a 10-year program, much like what we had to put a man on the moon. Germany has already put up enough solar panels to shut down 20 nuclear power plants. A week in September 14th, we're going to be talking, we'll spend a whole night giving people the updated knowledge on this new natural gas phenomenon called fracking. Fracking is not about getting gas for energy. It's about destroying the water table and creating a new gold rush for companies that want to go into the water business. And the Bush administration, the Bush family, incidentally, those of you that didn't know this, they bought 98,000 acres of land, a little corner of Paraguay. Well, that 98,000 acres sits over one of the world's largest freshwater aquifers. So there's already deals with pipeline companies to pipe fresh air, fresh water from the Great Lakes into Pennsylvania after the ground water and drinking water and everything is destroyed by fracking. You have to think ahead. These are the kinds of stories that are common knowledge all over the world, but unknown to Americans. As I mentioned earlier, Americans don't know that the rest of the world went with the World Report 5 years ago. June of 2008, 5 years ago, they said, the AIDS epidemic is over. We're sorry. They made a mistake in the United States. They've been telling people that they had HIV when HIV is really harmless. A lot of sick people have died, but they were poisoned by the pharmaceutical industry. 300,000 Americans died here because they were taking a fatal type of chemotherapy drug that had been renamed an antiviral drug. So knowledge moves forward in the direction of truth. We get beneficial knowledge, it's solid at the scientific level, then it spreads out into the population. And if we go with a lot of good knowledge that's being developed by countries all over the world, you know, we have 5% of the world's people. There's a lot of good things happening on the planet. And it doesn't have to continue to be this way. We can change things for the better. You know, it's our country has always been a struggle. But if anybody wants the information, take one of these flyers. It has websites on it, books. Or come to our talk September 14th. We'll have a whole new list of updated information currently what's happening in America and around the world. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, well, interesting stuff, good stuff, Bill. And I would have to say Ernie's rebuttal tonight was as good of a rebuttal, if that's the word for it, as any I've ever heard here in living memory. It was just outstanding. He covered a number of very important things, including the hot breweries and all that sort of stuff. So I have to associate myself essentially completely with everything he said. But I want to throw in other considerations. It seems clear to me that many of you here who are opposed to what Bill was talking about have, certainly by my lights, way too much trust in the current authorities. Folks, this society is crumbling. All right, the orgy of malgovernance to which it has been subjected, surely over the past decade, arguably the past two or three, is such that the best thing, by my lights, that can be said about the politicians running things nowadays, the best of them are self-deluders, and the worst of them are just plain sociopaths. Now there's your basic choice as to what we're dealing with nowadays. And for you to expect, to imagine, and much less expect, that this crowd will do anything other than see no evil, hear no evil, and or be evil, That's, you know, remember Bob Dole's thing about Carter, Ford, and Nixon. Hearing no evil, seeing no evil, and evil. That's, you know, that's what we've had ever since from our politicians. Now, and you expect these folks to do anything other than, by design or otherwise, enforce what laws exist, including the laws against concealed carry, etc. To expect that these laws will be enforced in any remotely consistent and fair manner is, as far as I'm concerned, to be expecting way too much of these people. And in all likelihood, by the way, the situation's going to just keep getting worse. The diseases, the mental diseases, if that's the word, within the elites in America are in all likelihood going to keep on growing. And the propensity of palms to be greased, corners to be cut, asses to be covered, etc., will keep on growing. And the prospects, by the way, that the cops will get there when you need them to get there and actually be under orders from the brass to stick their asses out for your sake when the gangbangers or whoever are showing up, those prospects are declining. And you're, one way or the other, you, whoever you are, unless you're a Kennedy or a Rockefeller or a related to Bernanke or a Bush or an Obama or any of these big shots, if you're not hooked into those social circles one way or the other, you're going to be hanging out to dry. And I, for one, have no intention, and certainly in the short run anyway, to take advantage of this concealed carry law. But, as Ernie has implied, it might behoove me for the criminal elements to not be so sure that I'm not packing. And that, for not only me, but for everybody here, is liable to turn out, as the years go by, to be an all but priceless advantage. And what's going to end up happening probably is, as the economy continues to deteriorate, as, you know, the slogan nowadays, in recent years anyway, has gone, the best way to rob a bank is to manage one. Okay? As those guys keep on feathering their nests, and it's not just them, they're the numbers of the elites who are partaking one way or the other. You've just got this big bunch of money. The American people are walking around with their pockets, you know, just stuffed with $100 bills, and the elites just sort of pick, you know, wanted to pick out a wad here and pick out a wad there. That's how it's going, and it's going to continue on going that way and get worse. And what's going to end up probably happening is that the elites are going to see to it, as the cops just continue to get either super militarized on the one hand, at least when a president shows up in town, or be defunded for all intents and purposes on the other hand. Well, you know, so the elites will have these nuclear armed armies protecting them, but Joe Blow and Jane Doe out on the street will have essentially nothing except what they can carry and perhaps conceal themselves. And that's where it's going, Chuck. Even again, hear no evil, see no evil.
They're not gonna answer 9/11 calls.
Well, we'll see how many of them can get there, how fast. This is what it comes down to. If you've got the phone ringing off the hook, 9/11, 9/11, 9/11, robbery here, murder there, everything else, there's only so many places you can be at once. In a society where, again, the elites are hearing no evil and seeing no evil. And they'll show you everything you need, more than you'd ever want to hear about O.J. Simpson or Nicole or Michael Jackson or whoever, but in terms of actually doing reporting about the kind of stuff that we heard tonight from our speaker and the kind of stuff that we heard for that matter from Ernie, where do you ever hear any of those kind of details? In the mass media, on the boot tube. I'd like to, maybe somebody knows somewhere where one can go on the boot tube. So no, you're gonna be hanging out to dry. And the one good possible effect of this, is, I suspect, is that at least some substantial percentage of the population, gee, now I can conceal carry. I should go get training that I wouldn't have thought of getting before. So that when, as things go down the drain, you're liable to have a higher percentage of those folks who would think of carrying, be actually be trained to do it well instead of mistakenly blowing people away left and right. I don't know how much time I've got left, but it's worth mentioning how often, with respect to folks who use the analogy of Dodge City. Folks, Dodge City was a TV. They're talking about TV shows, depictions of Dodge City. I'll wager you that maybe 1% at most of the folks who refer to the Dodge City analogy actually ever read jack shit about Dodge City. So turn off your TVs. It's only leading you down that show.
Thank you.
Do
you
really want to bring a gun in a public library?
Why?
Well, you would think that a church might be one of the safest places in, and generally they are. But I will always remember Mrs. Plummer. And she was one summer. She came in the church and sat down. It was a warm summer and a warm day, and her bosom was. Well, covered, but not entirely, It was, and there was this insect, a bee, that came in. Maybe it smelled the perfume, and it alit upon her bosom. And she brushed it away, only it didn't go away, it stung her. And it was a very uncomfortable place to sting her. There's no place, if she had had a gun, I don't think she should have aimed at the bee. But that's unfortunately the problem with guns generally. They, even when they are carefully aimed and you're a good shot and the conditions are right, it could be that it's a mistake to use the gun. Now, maybe 4% of our population are sociopaths, and they should. We would all be safer if we took out guns and shot them. But we don't. Know that the sociopath, and mostly those sociopaths, don't spend their lives shooting people. Maybe bamboozling them, conning them, doing one thing or another that is not that nice or right, maybe very harmful. But usually, most sociopaths apparently are not shooting up the place. Detecting who is a sociopath or a psychopath, and those are distinct terms, is a rather difficult job, and I don't trust either psychiatrists or sociologists to do it. It used to be said that the only good Indian is a dead Indian, but beware of those who go around shooting Indian. Well, let's see. If you want a safe society, I don't think declaring a place a gun-free zone is going to do it. I don't think that telling people that they can safely carry a gun is going to do it, because, you know, policemen's families have a much higher incidence of gun violence than non-police families, because they have guns, and most people don't have guns, except in some communities, some rural communities. Most people have guns because they're shooting at those varmints that are raiding the crops, or they have guns so they can go hunting or shooting just for recreational purposes. Guns are toys. It's not just the little kid, by the way, you know, the kid's water pistol or cap gun.
Time.
Is could be endangering them if people feel that they are. They have to shoot somebody with a gun. Jed.
Yes.
Jed Miller.
I am not going to speak on guns. It's just something that doesn't, I can't say doesn't interest me, it doesn't appeal to me. I just came to say, I'm just looking for some sympathy. Today is my 63rd birthday.
Oh,
and this is all I could find to do to celebrate my birthday, to come to a college of complexes, so you know how bad things are getting. But I always celebrate good on the 3rd and the 4th, you know, with every. So I figure if all these people want to get out and have parades and fireworks and picnics on the, you know, and they want to do it not exactly on my birthday, all right, they can do that. Yeah. So I did have a good time, and what's nice is after it's all over, this, it's not over because it's no letdown, because I got my real birthday to look forward to, and, you know, I try to do something. And I'm just, I had to come out. I wasn't going to stay in. I stayed in all day yesterday, and I'm feeling really down on it. Not so much that it's my birthday, but it's that my birthday, and I'm getting thrown out of my apartment. I have no place to live. I can't get a roommate. I have, you know, and I have no money, and all this. And it's my birthday, so I thought I'd come out here and I'd make you all sit and feel sorry for me. So that's all I wanted.
Perhaps we can take up a collection for a gun for him. Shoot the landlord.
Is that on camera?
Yes. One or two of you may be old enough to remember the Chicago Daily News, the cartoonist Al Capp.
Yeah.
He's famous, of course, for Little Abner, but he also had occasionally a strip called Fearless Fosdick. Fearless Fosdick was a detective at some large urban area. And I asked for the deference of our police contingent here tonight. But the strips were funny. When Fearless Fosdick was pursuing the criminal, he'd be shooting at random, and you'd find big holes in passers-by people, and never hitting the criminal. And so we do need training before we carry that gun.
Anybody else?
All right.
Yeah? Okay, wrap it up.
We
all
win.
Interesting, Charlie. You know I love you as much as my no good, lousy brother-in-law. Yes. So when I say this, you say we should call 911, right? Police will come and protect and save you, right? That's your choice. You know what? I think it was Oregon. This was in the news lately. Recently, a woman called and said her boyfriend was coming in, gonna beat her up, rape her, whatever. And the 911 dispatcher said, well, you know, we just don't have the resources to send anybody out to help you. Well, you know, he's gonna come in, he's gonna, you know, beat on me, rape me. Well, maybe you can talk him out of it. You know, yeah, she was raped. Yeah, call 911 because the police will be right there. Okay. You know, in the Constitution, it's called the Bill of Rights, not the Bill of Needs. And you know, there are people, some of the founders, who didn't even want a Bill of Rights, that's the first 10 amendments, included in the Constitution, because they thought, reasonably so, the founders, they were geniuses. They were really geniuses. You may take issues with little minutiae or something here and there, but the grand scheme of things, they really got things right. They were worried that if you put in a Bill of Rights, then people at some point in time would say, hey, if it's not in the Constitution Bill of Rights, you can't do that. The Constitution and Bill of Rights was to constrain government of what they can do to us or take away from us. It was not to constrain the citizenry. You know, I was in Afghanistan for a few months. I was surrounded by like 4,000 people with fully automatic weapons. I carry two guns on me most of the time. How many shootings on post do you think there were surrounded by 4,000 soldiers of a young testosterone-induced population? How many shootings do you think there were on the post in 6 months? And even accidental shootings. How many think there were?
None.
Must have been a few. I mean, guns, they're bad. People use them and they're going to kill somebody because that's what happens when you get a gun. There are no shootings. 6 months.
No shootings on the post?
With their firearms, nobody shot anybody. There weren't even accidental shootings, which is really something, because often, because when you go in a dining facility, you always have to clear your weapon and everything, and sometimes somebody will make a mistake, and they have a barrel where they point the pistol or rifle into and click, you know. Every once in a while, there'll be a pow. But I think the sergeant major said, no one will have an accidental discharge on this post. Got it, soldier? Yeah, okay. For sergeant, no problem, man. Thank you. Instead of a gun-free zone, we should call them target-rich environments or free fire areas. Okay, military terminology. Where do mass murders occur? Target-rich environments. The bad guys will always get a gun. Understand this. You can do whatever you can. Put a moat around your place, walls, everything else. The guns and the bad guys with the guns will always get through. Okay, so they'll get through. So what do? Well, I'm glad none of us have a gun. Yeah, we'll be safe. 1% of the firearms used in self-defense. You know, Charlie, my good friend, I send you the rebuttals to all this stuff. Don't you read it? Those are bogus statistics. The way they use these bogus statistics, they say, you know, more people are killed with a gun in the home than are shot by a person protecting themselves. Okay, so what? That's irrelevant. You can say 90% or 99% of the people who use a gun in self-defense don't even pull the trigger. Okay, yeah, it's cool, man. Hey, sorry, I'm out of here. Okay, don't shoot me. So to say that a gun is not used means it has no utility or purpose is very, very bogus. You don't have to pull the trigger. The statistic he's citing says more people are shot and killed in a home that has a gun than people protecting themselves shoot and kill an intruder. Yeah. But the gun still serves a purpose if you don't pull the trigger.
They shoot each other.
And also the statistics he cite has places like inner city Chicago, maybe, inner city Philadelphia, you know, real, in fact, what it's saying is they're high risk households in the first place. It's not like my house or the burbs, you know, we're talking about dangerous places. A lot of the statistics are derived from houses of criminality. Dope dealers, other criminals, yeah, they're dangerous because they have a gun. Maybe it's their lifestyle which makes them dangerous and not the gun. Oh, by the way, you know, only 1% of the people actually use a gun in self-defense. If I'm part of the 1%, you know, I guess that's important to me. You know, you think we ought to be part of a community and everything else, you know, protect the community's safety. Darn, Charlie, join a commune. You know, they'll tell you what to do and give you parameters and tell you how to live your life. And, you know, you fit right in. But I handed out the handouts. Who read my handouts? Yeah, okay, good. That's a good success rate. Thank you. So please read that handout. I think it's interesting and useful. It's a philosophical argument of why people like me choose to have guns, and how guns is a civilizing influence in society. Oh, the other thing, police, right? They're so good and highly trained in guns, right? Yeah, man, only police should have them. There's a shooter in New York City, went to his office building, shot up the place, free fire area, target-rich environment, shot up the place, went outside, a couple of police cornered him, and these police shot like 9 or 14 bystanders. The perpetrator didn't fire a shot, but there was 9 or 14 wounded people because of the cops. Then you have Bernard Goetz. He's the guy who defended himself against some screwdriver-wielding people on a New York City subway. He didn't shoot any civilians or innocent bystanders. Anyways, the police do not have superpower to protect you or to shoot straight. Thanks for having me. It's been worth the trip. Appreciate it.